गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट. सो वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद द ऑक्यूपेशनल हेल्थ एंड इन टुडेज लेक्चर सीरीज देर आर सम इम्पॉर्टेंट मेडिकल मेजर्स एंड देर आर सम इंजीनियरिंग मेजर्स एंड द लास्ट पार्ट इज अबाउट द लेजिस्लेटिव मेजर्स इन रिलेशन विद द ऑक्यूपेशनल हेल्थ. देर आर वेरियस एक्ट, वेरियस लेजिस्लेशन दैट आर मेड दैट वी विल बी कवरिंग टुडे. Last lecture we have considered about the occupational cancer, then we have discussed about the lead poisoning, we have discussed the various pneumoconiosis. So in relation with the prevention part, there are some important aspects, some measures that we can undertook in relation with the medical ground, then some measures that we can undertook depending upon the engineering measures like ventilation of the factory, the occupational environment, these factors can be considered. And another important thing, there are certain legislation that will help us in relation with the prevention and control of these occupational disorders. So today we will be starting with the measures of health protection of the worker. As outlined here in the slide, International Labour Organization and WHO Committee of the Occupational Health in 1953 recommended these measures. So as far as the nutrition part is important, immunity, when we talk about the epidemiological triad, agent, host and environment, this thing that we discuss. So there are some important host factors also that play role in relation with the occupational disease, and one of the important thing is about the nutrition. So it is not about the occupational environment, it is not about the various chemicals or the physical hazard that we need to concentrate, but when we are discussing the occupational health of the worker, nutrition is also equally important. And accordingly, as far as the Indian Factories Act is concerned, it is obligatory on the part of the industrial establishment to provide a canteen whenever the number of the employees exceeds 250. So you should remember, whenever any in factory there are 250 or more employees are there, at that time the canteen is must. So this is one photograph that will give you idea in relation with this nutrition and the whatever the facility that can be provided. As far as the communicable disease is concerned, as we have noted, in India the tuberculosis is more common, the typhoid fever, viral hepatitis, amoebiasis, intestinal parasites, and malaria and venereal diseases. These are the diseases that are common. So another important aspect, that adequate immunization that should be carried out for these occupational health workers. And special sanitary measures in relation with the handling of working materials and substances, that is also necessary as far as the communicable disease control is concerned. Now we'll come to important aspect, because these workers are working 8 hours, 12 hours in this industry, and at this time it is important there should be the sanitary supply of the water should be there, a sufficient supply of wholesome drinking water that should be present in the industry where they are working for 8 to 12 hours. Food part we have covered as far as the facility that we are providing as a canteen to these health workers. So the sanitary establishment is also essential as far as these different occupation and these different industries concerned. As far as toilet facility is concerned, there should be separate facility for male, female that should be available. In detail, we will discuss this particular point in relation with the Factories Act. Then there should be general plant cleanliness. It should be followed periodically. The wall, ceiling, passages, they should be painted periodically, because the lighting part is also important whenever these workers are working in this industry for long duration. There should be sufficient space, and what is the guideline that has been provided as far as the space in this industry is concerned, is there should be 500 cubic feet space that should be available to each worker. So, and these when we are calculating this space, the height more than 40 feet above the floor level is not taken into the consideration. So adequate distancing, social distancing, that should be maintained as far as these industry is concerned.
Thank you. धक्का लग सकते हैं।
सॉरी फॉर सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम। सो कमिंग बैक टू द पॉइंट, एज वी वर डिस्कसिंग दैट इज देयर शुड बी एटलीस्ट 500 क्यूबिक फीट स्पेस दैट शुड बी अवेलेबल एज फार एज ईच वर्कर इज कंसर्न्ड। देन वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस दिस पर्टिकुलर पॉइंट, देर आर मेनी इंडस्ट्री वेयर देर आई स्ट्रेन कैन बी पॉसिबल एंड द स्टैंडर्ड इल्यूमिनेशन फॉर डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ द वर्क हैज बीन सेट द प्रिसीजन वर्क for the high degree accuracy they may require the 50 to 75 foot candles, whereas the people work regularly 6 to 12 foot candles may be sufficient. So the message is that there should be adequate lighting that should be present wherever the workers are working. So this is one photograph that you can get idea, so the how the lighting and all these facility that are maintained in this particular industry. Ventilation and temperature is another important part when we are discussing the occupational health. So importance of the ventilation, effective suitable provision should be made for maintaining the adequate ventilation for these particular workers. Protection against the hazard, there are different types of the hazard that we have discussed in the previous lectures, and specific protection against these hazards in relation with the different types of the disease that already we have discussed. As far as possible, the housing facility, there is usually an acute shortage of the housing in industrial area. So the point that we have discussed, most of the time the occupational opportunity, the job opportunity that are available in the urban area, these workers, they are coming from the rural area, and at that time the shortage of the housing facility is possible. So if possible, these housing facility can be provided by that industry, and some industry are also having this particular facility. When we have started this lecture, one of the point that we have emphasized, it is not only the physical diseases or the different types of the hazards, different types of the pneumoconiosis that are important as far as the health of occupational health worker is concerned, but the mental health, maintaining the mental health, interpersonal relationship, conflict that are arising, the worker is having the job satisfaction or not, these are equally important point as far as the occupational health is concerned. So the goals of mental health should be promote health, happiness of the worker. As early as possible, we should understand the emotional stress, strain occurring because of these occupational diseases or occupational working, and the treatment of employees for these mental illness and the rehabilitation. All these are the important goals as far as the occupational health is concerned. Then, as we know, there are some industry where the woman or the children more than 14 years they are working. So woman workers require special protection because of the developing embryo, particularly during the pregnancy state, may be more susceptible to these occupational hazards, and special care should be taken in this particular situation. So again, this particular thing we will be discussing when we are going in detail about the legislation in relation with the occupational health. So there are facility that are provided, that is maternity leave for 12 weeks, some amendments that has also happened as far as the maternity leave is concerned, provision of free antenatal, natal, postnatal services. Factories Act prohibits the night work between 7 p.m. to 6 a.m. Particularly in relation with the woman, they should be not allowed to carry the excessive weight. So these are the special recommendation that has been given as far as the female health worker, female industrial worker is concerned. Indian Mine Act prohibits the work underground for the female. The Factories Act 1976 provides the creches in the factory. Now this important point, whenever she is having infant under 5 child with her, so it is essential to provide the creches in the factories whenever the more than 30 women worker are working in that particular factory. So one of the facility that we have discussed is there should be canteen whenever the more than 250 workers are there. As far as the female health worker is concerned, female worker, industrial worker is concerned, there should be creche facility that should be available if the more than 30 women that are working in that particular industry. Every one of you are aware in relation with the Child Labour Act. So the children below 14 years shall not be employed in the work in any factory. This is a particular thing that is as far as the Child Labour Act is concerned. Health education, again, whatever the the diseases that we are discussing, unless and until the awareness and education that is there among the workers, our goal will not be achieved. Family planning facility, advice, counseling, and whatever the requirement, that should be provided. And another important aspect that we will be discussing in today's lecture is about the ESIS Act. So this particular care, this particular facility that are provided under the Employee State Insurance Act, the medical facility that are provided to the industrial worker. So after this discussing this particular part, the most important thing that is about the it is not essential that we can provide the medical facility to the worker. We can take measures in relation with the various environmental factors that are playing role as far as the industrial workers is concerned. But sometimes all these are also having the limitation, and it is essential that we should make certain laws in relation with the occupational or the industrial workers' health. So on this background, initially we will discuss about the some medical and engineering measures, and then third part, as far as the prevention and control of the occupational health is concerned, occupational disease is concerned, that is, there are some legislation, there are certain law that are made in our country as far as the prevention of these diseases and maintaining the health among the industrial worker, that we will be discussing in the last part of this lecture. So what we can do, we have discussed the diseases like pneumoconiosis, we have discussed the diseases like lead poisoning, there are some occupational health cancer that are more common among these industrial workers. We have discussed the problem of the agriculture workers and the diseases that are common among the agriculture workers. We have also discussed in relation with the problem of the sickness absenteeism. So now we are having the idea what are the different diseases that are more common in occupational worker as compared to general population. So when we are planning the preventive and measures, so preventive measures in relation with the occupational diseases can be grouped under the three heading. First is the medical measures that can be undertaken, that we can undertook as far as the prevention of this disease is concerned. Some engineering measures that already we have discussed in relation with the ventilation and lighting, but in detail we will be discussing under this point. And there are some statutory or the legislative measures that can be undertaken to maintain the preserve the health of occupational worker. So as far as the medical measures is concerned, you are now familiar with this particular concept of the pre-placement examination. So what is this pre-placement examination? It is nothing but before we are employing a particular worker in the industry, you also might be aware, whenever you get any job, you have to give the fitness certificate. And this is what is the important thing as far as, but it is beyond that. When we are employing a particular worker, and if he is having certain diseases, he will not be suitable in particular industry. So the pre-placement examination role is important. So before occurring the disease, we are preventing that particular disease in that particular worker when we are understanding the hazard that might be possible. So in general, when we are carrying out the pre-placement examination for the industrial worker, some basic investigation that we carry out, like the chest x-ray, the ECG, the vision testing is also important, because we have also discussed about the accident in the industry, urine blood examination, special test for the endemic diseases that should be carried out. Now why it is important? Now we'll take some example here. So suppose we are going to employ that particular worker in the lead industry. So what is the hazard that is there? If the lead is hazard and the particular worker is already suffering from anemia, hypertension, nephritis or the peptic ulcer, so these are the undesirable condition. So work person suffering from anemia, hypertension, nephritis, peptic ulcer, they should not be employed in the industry where the lead is used. We have discussed the lead poisoning in detail. At that time also we have seen there are some organic lead and inorganic lead. These are the subtypes, and what are the clinical features, signs, symptoms in relation with the lead poisoning. So if these undesirable conditions that are there, these workers should not be employed in the industry where the lead is used. Second example here we can take is the dyes. Now suppose a particular industry is there where the dyes are used. and the work we are doing the pre-placement examination, and the person is having asthma, skin, bladder, kidney disease, or the precancerous lesion. In that situation, he should not be employed in the dyes industry. So if you are last lecture, we have discussed about the occupational cancer. So one of the thing that we have discussed is the bladder cancer is more common in the worker who is working in the dyes industry. So this is the principle. If a particular person is already having the asthma, already is having the skin, bladder and kidney diseases, then he should not be employed in the dyes industry. If the solvents are used and the person is having the liver, kidney diseases or dermatitis, or he is having the addiction in relation with the alcohol, then definitely he should not be employed in the industry. Then silica, we have discussed in detail about the silicosis. So the person, we have discussed the condition silicotuberculosis. So naturally, what precaution here we are going to take? If the person is having healed or active tuberculosis of the lung or the chronic lung disease, in this situation, as we know, there is the hazard is that fibrosis of the lung that occurs in relation with the silicosis. So such person should not be employed where the silica is used. Signs of ill health, especially the blood diseases are there, then he should not be employed where there is a exposure to the radium or X-ray is there. We have seen the various hazards, acute and chronic hazards in relation with the radiation, the blood cancer is, leukemia is common in such situation. And if person is already having the underlying blood disease, in that situation he should not be employed wherever there is a radium or X-ray exposure is there. So I hope you understood now the importance of the pre-placement examination. Now is our job is over, we have done the pre-placement examination, the worker is working in that industry, it's not. So it is essential to carry out the periodic examination. And now we'll take few examples where you will understand the periodic examination doesn't mean that we should carry out 1 year examination or 2 year, once in 5 year. It will vary depending upon the industry to the industry. Periodic examination means at regular interval we should carry out the examination of these particular workers. So if the ordinary workers in general where there is no significant hazard in that industry, it is sufficient. We should carry out the annual examination or once a year examination, that is sufficient. Now we'll take the example of some industry where the lead, toxic dye or the radium is used. In that situation, the monthly examination are indicated. So it is possible to identify the disease at early and then treatment can be given and various complications that can be prevented. Now, as I have said, in some industry even the daily examination may be needed. So which is this particular industry where the irritant chemicals are used, where the skin problem are likely to occur or the other hazards are likely to occur, and which is the example of these skin irritant, wherever the dichromates are used, in that industry even the daily examination will be essential. So I hope you understood now the concept of the periodic examination. The industry where there is not more risk is there, in general we can carry out the annual examination. Some industry the monthly examination is essential, weekly examination is essential, and in some industry even the daily examination, daily periodic examination will be necessary to identify the hazard. Medical and healthcare services that are provided, immunization may be required in some industry, and in detail we will discuss this particular factor under the heading of the Employee State Insurance Act at the end of this particular lecture. Now what is the meaning of notification? Whatever the diseases that are occurring in the industry, it is the duty of that particular employer, they should be notified, they should be informed to particular authority, and this is what is the concept of the notification. We'll be discussing about the Factories Act, there are Mines Act is there, then the Dock Labours Act is there. So under these various acts, the different diseases, if they occur in that particular industry while working, they should be notified to the authority. And what is the purpose of the notification? It helps in the initiating the measures for the prevention and protection of the worker. Then there should be periodical supervision of the working environment that should be carried out to prevent the various occupational accident, the various occupational disability that can be prevented if we find out any accident prone spot in that particular industry. Simultaneously, we have taken the many examples, the various research that has already published as far as the occupational diseases, occupational hazard is concerned. So the maintenance of the record is important to carry out the research in relation with the occupational diseases. Health education, counseling, this is again repeatedly I will be saying this particular part. Unless until the industrial worker is aware about these particular hazards, the preventive measures that are available, personal protective measure that should be used, the ultimate goal of prevention and control of the occupational diseases will not be achieved. Now we have discussed about the medical measures that can be taken as far as the prevention of the and control of the diseases among the industrial worker. Now we are going to the engineering measures that can be added to, that can be that are essential in that particular industry if we have to prevent the whatever the hazard that we have discussed in the previous 2-3 lectures. One important thing is the design of the building. So type of the floor, walls, height, ceiling, roof, doors, windows, cubic space. One factor that we have discussed is the ventilation. So all these factors that are important when we are considering the design of the building in relation with the prevention and control of the disease, in relation with the prevention of the accident in that industry. So there is a concept of good housekeeping. So what is the good housekeeping? It is term often applied in industry, and it means much as the same as used when domestically. So in our home we use this particular word good housekeeping, that is also applicable as far as the industry is concerned. Ventilation, there are many diseases that are chance of occurrence is there if the proper ventilation is not maintained. So how this good general ventilation can be maintained in the industry, and the hazards like the airborne hazard that can be prevented if the proper ventilation is available in the industry. So the Indian Factories Act prescribed minimum 500 cubic feet airspace for each worker. We'll see these Factories Act and the recommendation under the Factories Act when we are discussing about the occupational diseases. Now this is one interesting thing, mechanization. So as we say, newer and newer technology that are coming, and that has helped in improvement of our life. So similarly, that is also applicable as far as the industrial health is concerned. So what can be done in relation with the industrial health of the worker? Mechanization. So whenever, we'll take one example, dermatitis can be prevented if the hand mixing is replaced by the mechanical devices. So newer and newer technology that is applicable. So whatever the work we used to do, that worker used to do with the help of his hand, now that can be replaced by machine, mechanical devices, and here we can easily prevent the occupational dermatitis. Acid can be conveyed from one place to another place through the pipe. So here we are also preventing the accident that can result because of the exposure to the acid. Another concept is there as far as the occupational health is concerned, and what is this term that is used is called as the substitution. You will understand when we'll take few examples of the substitution. A classic example of the substitution is white phosphorus. Substitution of white phosphorus by the phosphorus sesqui sulfide. Where it is used, you might be aware, this phosphorus is used generally in the match industry, and this is important as far as the causation of the phossy jaw is concerned. So we can replace it with the safer compound, and our purpose of making match, that is also solved. So this is what is the concept of the substitution. Wherever it is possible, the hazardous compound that can be replaced by the safer compound. Zinc or iron paints can be used in a place of the harmful lead paints. So we know, even for the toys that are prepared for the children, there are chances that the lead paint and all these things that are used, and it can be hazardous. So in such situation, it is possible, if possible, zinc or iron paints can be used instead of using the lead paints. Silver salt can be used in the place of the mercury. Acetone can be used in the place of the benzene. So more hazardous compound can be substituted by the safer compound. Dust is another hazard. We have discussed about the pneumoconiosis, how this dust can cause the fibrosis of the lung and the various organic, inorganic pneumoconiosis that are there. So in this situation, the weight drilling of the rock, if it is done, then there are more chance of the exposure to the dust is there. Inclusion of little moisture in the materials will make the process of grinding, sieving or mixing comparatively less dust free. So these are the very cost effective, low cost measure to avoid the more exposure to the dust in that particular industry. Enclosure. Enclosing the harmful materials process will prevent the escape of the dust and fumes into the factory atmosphere. For example, the grinding machinery can be completely exposed. So here we are preventing the hazards in relation with the exposure of this hazardous compound. Isolation. Now this is again one important engineering concept as far as the occupational disease is concerned. Sometimes it may be necessary to isolate the offensive process in a separate building. So the workers who are not directly exposed, they will not get this hazard. So here we are doing the isolation in terms of the space. We are using these hazardous work that is carried out in some separate building. And isolation can be done in terms of the time also. So certain occupation can be done at the night, so the workers who are doing the work during the daytime, they are not exposed to this type of the hazard. So now you understood the concept of the isolation. Isolation can be in terms of the space, and isolation can be done in terms of the time. In terms of the space, we can carry out these hazardous work in the different buildings, so other workers who are not directly exposed, they will not get exposure. And in terms of the time, so some activities in the industry, they can be carried out at the night time, so the other daytime workers, they are not exposed to these particular hazards. Local exhaust ventilation. Already you are aware about the importance and the role of the exhaust ventilation as far as the these air purification and the airborne disease is concerned. Protective devices. Whenever we have discussed the various occupational diseases, at that time also we have discussed the role of the protective devices. Like suppose there is a exposure to the noise is there, then ear muffs that can be used. The respiratory disorders risk is there, the pneumoconiosis risk is there at that time. The personal protective measures like the mask or the respirator that can be used. The protective clothing, goggles, boots. All these are the important protective devices that are available and that should be used in that particular industry. So here in this figure you can see the earmuffs that are there, and whenever there is excessive exposure to the noise is there as the hazard that we have discussed. There might be temporary hazard, there might be some permanent hazards like deafness that can be there in the industry where the excessive noise exposure is there. Then there is essential to do the environmental monitoring in relation with this occupational industry, because whenever there is an increase in the to the specific limit, excessive hazard that is there, in that situation the proper intervention that can be done. Statistical monitoring, or already we have discussed this point, that is the record should be maintained, the notification that should be carried out in relation with the industry, that we diseases that are common, that will help us in relation with the future planning. So the research is again important part. Now we'll come to the last part in relation with this occupational health series, and from next Tuesday onwards we'll be starting with the new topic. So what we have discussed today, as far as the prevention and control of the occupational disease is concerned, there are some medical measures that are there, there are some engineering measures that are there, and again there are limitation of these medical or engineering measures. So it is essential to have certain laws in relation with the prevention and control of the diseases among the occupational or the industrial worker. So which are these law? The two important law that are there as far as the industrial worker is concerned. One is the Factories Act and another is the Employee State Insurance Act. So in the last we will be discussing about these two acts in relation with the occupational health. So we'll begin with the Factories Act 1948. The first Indian Factories Act dates back to the 1881, and it is essential with the as the time passes there are some amendments that are made, there are some new guidelines that are given under this act. So the act was revised and amended several times, and the latest being latest amendment that is available as far as the Factories Act is concerned is in 1987. So what is the scope for these factories act? This act applies to the whole India except the state of Jammu and Kashmir. And act defines the factory where the establishment employing 10 or more workers where power is used, where the electricity is used, and the 20 or more workers where the power is not used. So health, safety and welfare measures are there under the chapter of 3, 4 and 5 under the Factories Act. And which are these health and safety measures? The treatment of waste and effluent that should be carried out properly. There should be proper facility that should be available as far as the elimination of the dust and fumes is concerned. And already one point that we have discussed under the heading of the engineering measures, that each worker should have minimum 500 cubic feet as far as the ventilation is concerned. And the factories installed before 1948, this cutoff is 500 cubic feet. Instead of 500, their guidelines is that there should be minimum 350 cubic feet space that should be available for each worker. As far as the 1976 amendment in this Factories Act of 1948, one thing that has been recommended that there should be safety officers in every factory whenever the 1000 or more workers are ordinarily employed. So there should be separate post of safety officer that should be there in that particular industry whenever the 1000 workers are there or more than that is there. Already this point we have discussed under the heading of the nutrition. So whenever in a particular factory the 250 workers are there, the canteen is compulsory. The provision of the facility like the canteen is essential, but the cutoff number that you should not forget, the 250 workers are there should be canteen. 1000 workers are there should be the post of the security officer in that particular industry. Second thing, as far as the 1976 amendment that already we have discussed under the heading of the special measures for the women and children. So the crèches should be there whenever the 30 women workers are ordinarily employed. So to repeat, 1000 and more workers are there should be safety officer should be there. More than 250 workers are there should be canteen facility that should be provided. More than 30 women workers are there, the crèches facility should be provided. Now another recommendation under the Factories Act is there, whenever the 500 or more workers are ordinarily employed in the factory, there should be welfare officer should be there. So to sum up, 500 and more workers are there, welfare officer. 1000 and more workers are there should be safety officer. More than 30 women are working, then there should be crèche facility that should be available. More than 250 workers are working, canteen facility should be available. So these are the important highlights as far as the Factories Act is concerned. Employment of young person, act prohibits the employment of children below the age of 14 years. So you might be familiar about the concept of the child labor. If the age of that particular child is less than 14 years, he cannot be employed. And even if the child in between the 15 to 18 or the adolescent that are employed in the factory, they should not be allowed to work in the hazardous process. Restrictions have been laid down the employment of women and children in certain dangerous occupation. If the adolescent is working in that particular factory, he should be allowed to work only during the 6 a.m. to 7 p.m. So night work is not permitted if the adolescent worker, and that is also more than 14 years if he is working in that particular factory. Hours of the work, that are also guidelines that are given as far as the Factories Act is concerned. So the Act prescribed maximum 48 hours work per week, not exceeding 9 hours per day, with the rest of at least half hours after every 5 hours. And for adolescent, hours of work have been reduced to 5 to 4 and half per day. So these are the guidelines, and you can understand the importance of these particular guidelines. So the fatigue will not be developed, the accident chances that are there when adequate break that are given after continuous hours of the work. Leave with wages, one day for every 20 days of the work. So there is a concept of earned leave or the privileged leave that is there. And for children, one day leave for every continuous 15 days of work. That are also guidelines that are given under the Factories Act. So the it is obligatory on the part of the factory management to give the information, whatever the accident, whatever the diseases that are developing in relation with that factory, the point that we have covered under the heading of the notification. Employment in hazardous process specific, it is a responsibility of the occupier in relation with the hazardous process, and proper notification, proper prevention and control measures that should be taken. The last part of this lecture, the second legislation that we will be discussing today is about the Employee State Insurance Act 1948. And as we have discussed in relation with the Factories Act, there are also amendments, regular amendment that has occurred as far as these Employee State Insurance Act is concerned. So whatever the relevant amendment, even till the 2020, there are some amendments that are there in ESIS Act. All these things that we'll be discussing. Some of the amendments may not be available in the old edition of your textbook. So kindly note down whatever the recent amendments that are there as far as the ESIS Act. Hardly 2 to 3 important changes that are there that we'll discuss when we'll be discussing about the Employee State Insurance Act. So ESI, or the full form is the Employee State Insurance Act. It was passed in 1948 and it was amended in the past in 1975, 1984, 1989, and some revision that has also taken in 2018 and 2020. So all these relevant revision that we will be discussing in relation with the ESIS Act. So first we should understood to which factory this ESIS Act is applicable, what is the scope of this ESIS Act. This act extend to the whole of the India, and the ESIS Act of 1948 covered all power using factory where other than seasonal factory where the 20 or more persons are employed, excluding the mine, railways and defense system, because this railway or the mines or the defense, they are having the separate health facility are provided to the workers who is working in the railway or the defense establishment. So they are not covered under this ESIS Act. So small power using factories where the 10 to 19 persons are working, there also the ESIS Act is available. So it is not applicable only to the industry, even the shops, hotel, restaurants, cinema theaters, road motor transport establishment, newspaper establishment. So here you can must have understood what is the scope. So it is not whatever the diseases that we have discussed, it is not applicable to the certain industry or certain factories, but shop, hotel, restaurant, cinema, theater, road motor transport, newspaper establishment, all these industry, the ESIS Act is applicable. With the effect from October 2010, the Act covers all the employees such as the manual, clerical, supervisory, technical, getting up to the 15,000 per month. And what is the recent revision that you may not find in the some old edition of the park, that is, this has been further revised to the employee that are getting up to 21,000 per month in September 2016. So initially the employee who is getting the 15,000 per month, they were included under the ESIS Act. Now again the revision that has occurred in 2016, and the this cutoff has been raised to 21,000 per month. They are also covered under the scope of the ESIS Act. Now what is the administration of this ESIS Act? There is a ESI corporation is there, Union Minister of Labour is the chairman, and Secretary to Government of India, Ministry of Labour is the vice chairman for this corporation. And there are some members, they are representing central, state governments, employees, employers. There is a standing committee that is there under this ESIS Act. But the four important pillar of the ESIS Act are, there are four person that are majorly carrying out this work. One is the insurance commissioner, second is medical commissioner, third is the financial commissioner, and actuary or the clerk who accountant who is maintaining these records. So there is a medical benefit council which is headed by Director General of the Health Services of the Government of India, who is assisted by medical commissioner. So we understood the structure of the ESIS. Now about the finance, the employer contribute 4 points. So when we are discussing the insurance scheme, definitely there is a contribution from both. That is, the employer also contributing and employee also contributing. So employer contribute 4.75% of the wage bill, while the employee contribute 1.75% of the wage bill. And state government share is 1/8, while the ESI corporation share the expenditure of the medical care is 7/8 of the total cost of the medical care. Now the important point, again as far as your examination is concerned, many times the full question that has been asked, what are the benefits to the employer and employee under the Employee State Insurance Act. So these are the important headings. First we will see the heading and then we will discuss individually what are the important components under the ESI Act. First is the medical benefit, sickness benefit, maternity benefit, disablement benefit, dependent benefit, funeral expenses and the rehabilitation allowance. So one by one we will discuss the benefits that are given under the Employee State Insurance Act. So what is the meaning of the medical benefit? As name itself indicates, we are providing full medical care including the hospitalization. So it is not only the OPD care that is provided under the ESI Act, but in certain situation we are also providing the IPD facility to the worker in the industry where any hazards that occurs. So we are giving the OPD treatment free of cost, because as this is an insurance scheme, both employee employer they are contributing. And what is the benefit of participating under this insurance scheme? That they are giving some free treatment, that like the OPD, supply of drugs, essential specialist services from all branch, pathological and radiological investigation, domiciliary services, in case of the woman, the free antenatal, natal and postnatal services that are given under the medical benefit, whatever these benefit that is given under the ESI Act. Then the immunization services, family planning services, emergency services, ambulance services, health education and inpatient treatment. So now you must have understood what are the benefits that are given to the industrial workers if they are participating, and the option is not there. The some cutoffs are definitely there in terms of the their monthly wage. If they are fulfilling the criteria, in that situation under this insurance scheme they are given these different benefit under the heading of the medical benefit. As far as the medical care is concerned, it is provided through the directly through the agency of the ESIS hospital. So you might have observed in India, in the different state, these ESIS hospitals are there and they are provided, they are providing the facility, what we call as the direct services. Another part is there under this ESIS Act, some indirect services are also provided by the private practitioner. So what we call it as the panel system. So under ESIS, we are providing the services by two way. One is the direct, that is the ESIS hospitals are there, where they are providing the services specifically to the industrial workers. Another is the panel system is there. So particular eligible private practitioner is also acting as a medical providing services that are provided by this private practitioner, and what we call it as the panel system. So where this direct pattern is available, applicable, whenever the concentration of more than 1000 industrial workers are there, in that condition the direct ESIS hospitals that are there available. In areas where the employees are less than 750, the part-time ESIS dispensary are available. And in residential area, concentration of the employees is scattered, where the less industry and all these workers that are available, so the mobile dispensaries are also available under the ESIS Act. And the indirect system, this what we already discussed, is called as the panel system under the ESIS Act, where the registered medical practitioner is designated as an insurance medical practitioner, and they are providing the services where there is a the scattered industry that are there, where the concentration of the industrial worker is less. Other medical facility that are provided by these under these ESIS scheme, like the even in some accidents occur, if there is a need is there, then artificial limb and all these that are provided, the denture spectacle, hearing aids that are provided free to the patient, special appliances such as the hernia belt, walking caliper, surgical boots, spinal braces, these are also provided to these industrial worker. So we have covered first benefit, that is the medical benefit under the ESIS Act. Second is the sickness benefit. So name itself indicates if that particular person is sick because of the working in that particular industry, in that situation the sickness benefit is given to the worker. So the benefit is payable for maximum period of 91 days, and in some unexceptional situation this benefit can be extended up to the 365 days. So you can understood easily that in some situation, if the accident is there, the prolonged sickness benefit is essential. In that situation, it can be extended up to the 365 days. Minimum is 91 days. Extended sickness benefit, whatever this thing we have discussed, so that can be extended for a longer period. There are some diseases that are given under the heading where the extended sickness benefit is given to the worker, and this was amended in 2000. So here we will see the example of the diseases where the extended sickness benefit, that is more than 91 days the sickness sick leave is given to that particular worker. So infectious diseases like the tuberculosis, leprosy, cancer condition, neoplasm, the disorders of the nervous system like hemiplegia, monoplegia. So the worker is having paralysis while working in the industry. In that situation, the 91 days may not be sufficient and extended sickness benefit is given. Disorders of the cardiovascular system, myocardial infarction, AMI, angina. So in this situation, the worker may require more than 91 days of the leave. So extended sickness benefit is given. Lung diseases like COPD, or the heart failure, diseases of the digestive system, that is the cirrhosis of the liver, ascites, in that situation also he will require the extended sickness benefit. Orthopedic diseases, traumatic condition or the surgical amputation, in this situation the extended sickness benefit will require. Psychosis, schizophrenia, you can understand, these diseases will also require the extended sickness benefit. So after discussing the medical benefit, sickness benefit under the ESIS heading, the third benefit is the maternity benefit. So in this situation, that particular woman is given, suppose for confinement the duration of benefit is 12 weeks, and if she is having abortion, in that situation the 6 week days leave with pay that is given to that particular woman, and benefit is allowed about full wages. Miscarriage or the medical termination of pregnancy in situation of MTP payable for 6 weeks, that is the 42 days from the date of the following miscarriage, on the basis of the form 20 and 23. So these are the technical word as far as the ESIS Act is concerned. In the event of the death of insured woman during the confinement, leaving behind child, maternity benefit is payable to her nominee on the production of form 24. Again, this is the technical word, these different types of the form that are available under this insurance scheme. So in this situation, the benefit is given to the nominee of that particular woman. In case of confinement, maternity benefit is increased from rupees 5000 to 7500. And remember, this is the recent amendment, this is the recent change. Again, I will repeat, in case of the confinement, maternity benefit is increased from, previously it was 5000, now it is 7500, and this amendment that was made on 30 October 2020. Disablement benefit, so we have discussed the various accidents that are common in the different types of the industry, and in this situation any disablement occur, any disability occur, any accident occur, so the disablement benefit is given to that particular person. And the rate of temporary disablement benefit is about 70% of the wages as long as the temporary disablement lasts. And in case of the total permanent disablement, the insured person is given life pension. So now here you can know what is the importance of the ESIS scheme as far as the industrial worker is concerned. Dependent benefit, so if because of certain situation death occur while working in that particular industry, in that case the some benefit is given in terms of the monetary term to the nominee of that particular worker, and the pension at the rate of 70% of the wages is payable shared by the dependent in a fixed ratio for the monthly basis. The eligible son or daughter is entitled for dependent benefit till he or she completes the age of 18, and after the age of 18 these benefits are withdrawn. So I hope you understood the dependent's benefit. So in case of the death of that particular worker, the benefit is given to his son or the daughter, and this benefit is given only till they reaches up to the age of 18. Funeral expense. So here you will not use the word benefit. Funeral expense. So a cash payment on the death of the insured person for the funeral expense not exceeding 10,000. So this is what you will find in some old edition. But remember, from with effect from April 2011, this amount is raised to 15 with effect from 19 September 2018. So now funeral expenses is 15,000. Rehabilitation. On monthly payment of rupees 10, the insured person and his family members continue to get medical treatment after permanent disablement or the retirement. So even the worker is retired, even he is not able to work because of some disablement, so nominal monthly payment of rupees 10, he is going to get the all the medical facility if he is having the permanent disablement or even after his retirement. So is it only that there are only the employer benefited under the ESIS Act? It is not that. Even the employer who is implementing these ESIS scheme, there are some benefits that are also there for the employer. First important benefit is the exemption from the applicability of Workman Compensation Act. So naturally, now you imagine this ESIS Act is not there and in any hazard or any accident occur, so the liability will be with the employer to give this compensation. Now when these employer are participating in the ESIS scheme, so there is a exemption or whatever the applicability of the Workman Compensation Act will not be applicable for that employer. Second thing, there is exemption from Maternity Benefit Act 1961. So already some maternity benefits that are there under the ESIS scheme, and that will be taken care by ESIS Act. Exemption from the payment of medical allowance to the employees and their dependents. So we have seen the various facility that are available under the ESIS scheme. So all these facility will be given to that particular employer. Rebate under the Income Tax Act on the contribution deposited in the ESIS account. So whatever the contribution that employer is doing, some exemption is given under the ESIS Act. So that is again monetary benefit to that particular employer. And what is most important thing, when that worker is aware that he is getting the medical facility, there are even if the some sickness occur, he is getting the wages. In case of the disablement, he is getting some benefits. In case of the maternity, pregnancy, or in case of the abortion, the worker is getting some assistance. So definitely there are chance that there will be healthy workforce and more production that is possible in that particular factory. So to sum up, we have taken 3 to 4 or 5 lectures in relation with the occupational health. Every part that we have covered in relation with the occupational health. To begin with, we have discussed about the different types of the occupational hazard. In second lecture, we have discussed about this, how these occupational hazards are causing the different diseases. To begin with, we have discussed the organic, inorganic dust and the pneumoconiosis that is resulting, the different types of the pneumoconiosis like silicosis, asbestosis, farmer's lung, biocinosis, all these diseases that are common because of the exposure to the dust. The next thing that we have discussed about the occupational cancer, lead poisoning, occupational dermatitis. In India, it is essential to discuss the most of the people, they are dependent on the agriculture. So the hazards of the agriculture workers that we have discussed in this particular lecture series. The next important part, we have discussed about the occupational cancer, the some occupational cancer that are more common as compared to the general population. The next important thing is the one concept, that is the sickness absenteeism, and it is not the only common because of the worker is having medical condition, but there are some other causes are also there for the sickness absenteeism. The next part that we have discussed about the medical measures, engineering measures in relation with the prevention and control of all these occupational hazard. Lastly, in today's lecture, we have discussed about the some legislative measures. So as far as the exam point is concerned, remember the pneumoconiosis, or these ESIS Act or the Factories Act, the medical measures and engineering measures in relation with the prevention and control of the disease in the occupational worker, all these can be asked as the full question is concerned. The various subheadings that we have discussed, the short answer question, that are also important as far as this occupational health is concerned. So to sum up, we have covered some important points in relation with the occupational health, the hazards of the industrial workers, preventive control measures in relation with this industry, and lastly we have covered about the legislation that are important as far as then how they are important, how they are important as far as the prevention and control of these occupational disease. So this is about the occupational health. Next lecture will be starting with some new topic.
थोड़ा ही तो लैग ही तो है।